faithfulness, O God.
Your grace is enough.
You know my every move. And your eyes see me in the dark. When I hear your name, I go lonesome. For your presence in my life. When I hear your name, I fall. Jehovah Rapha, come and be my healer again. Jehovah, Nisi, come and fight my battles and win. Jehovah.
Song about remembering the goodness of God when you're in the middle of your storm. Anybody know what I'm talking about? And believe me, he can do it again. If that's you this morning, let's sing this one loud. Come on.
Walking around these walls, I thought by now they'd fall. But you have never failed me yet. Waiting for change to come. Knowing the battle's won. For you have never failed me yet. Your promise still stands. Great is your faithfulness, faithfulness. I'm still in your hands. This is my confidence. You'll never fail me, yeah. Your word will come to pass.
Yes.
My heart will sing your praise again.
Oh, I believe it.
Cause Jesus, you're still enough to keep me within your love. your praise again. Oh, your promises, yeah. Your promise still stands. Great is your faithfulness, faithfulness. I'm still in your hands. This is my confidence. You never fail, no, no, no. Your promise still stands. Great.
Let's go, come on, put your hands together.
Yeah. I remember
somebody give him a shout today. Yes, Lord. Oh, thank you, Jesus. Somebody say thank you, Jesus, this morning. Oh, Jesus, we lift high your name today. And we remember your goodness. We remember where you've brought us out from. We see where we are now. And we look back and we see where we were then. And we say, thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Oh, we bless your name. Can we lift our hands this morning? Let's just lift high his name. We lift you high this morning, Jesus. We bless your name. We glorify you. We magnify you, Jesus. We magnify you, Jesus. John the Baptist said, he must increase and I must decrease. That's our prayer this morning, that you would increase. Oh, we bless your name. We glorify you. Be glorified by our praise. Be glorified by our lives, God. Be glorified by our testimonies. Let us be testimonies of your goodness and your grace and your mercy and your favor and your providence. Oh, we bless your name. We thank you so much, Jesus. And we glorify you today. I just pray a special blessing on everyone here, everyone watching at home right now. Special blessing on them right now, God. Just give them a sweet touch today, God, of your Spirit. We thank you for all these things. We ask all these things in Jesus' name. Can everybody say amen this morning? Amen, amen. Have a seat.
Amen. Good morning, Fellowship of the Nation. Thank y'all so much for joining us this morning. And as you participate in our worship, we also want to invite you to participate in our tithes and offerings this morning. Whether you're giving on FOTN.org, through our text mobile giving, or through the envelope that is sitting in front of you. As always, we just encourage you to step out in faith and to trust the Lord once again this morning. Because if we just sang that he's done it before, he can do it again. Amen? Amen. Let's go ahead and pray. God, we thank you so much that your faithful hand is stretched out towards us, even in times of our lack of faithfulness, Lord. And so I pray that your faithful heart would compel us to want, to desire, thirst, and just hunger to walk in obedience and walk in righteousness, Lord. We pray for this offering this morning. We thank you, Lord, that when we give to you, Father, that we're not giving in vain, Lord. We're giving to a promise keeper and a way maker, Lord. And so we ask, God, that you would take this offering this morning, that you would multiply it and use it for your glory, Lord, and that it would not only change our lives, but it would impact our families, our communities, and the nations around the world, Lord. We continue to ask you to bless and hover over this service this morning as the word comes forth. We thank you, Holy Spirit, and that as you do a work in us and as we open our hearts to you and incline our ears to your voice, Father, I thank you, Lord, that in Jesus' name we are leaving here differently than the way we walked in, Lord. We love you and we thank you for that honor. And it's in Jesus' name we pray. And all God's people said, amen.
Amen, amen. Do we have Kid Nation in the house today? Can we give them a hand, please?
There's a lot of kids, huh? Okay, remember what we practice? Focus right here. Okay, they're here, but they're going to worship with us. We're going to do our scripture. You ready? I'm going to put the microphone down. Okay, say it as loud as you can. Blow my hair off.
Luke 19:10.
Luke 19:10.
loves me, he can do anything. If I run over here, if I run over there, God is everywhere, and he loves me. When I look up, 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 I know he's real. When I look down, 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 I believe what I found. When I look in God's word and I search for him, he rewards me, 'cause he loves me. God made me, he made everything. God loves me, he can do anything. If I run over here, if I run over there, God is everywhere, and he loves me. When I look up, 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 I know he's real. When I look down, 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 I believe what I found. When I look in God's word and I search for him, he rewards me, 'cause he loves me. When I look up, 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 I know he's real. When I look down, 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 I believe what I found. When I look in God's word and I search for him, he rewards me, 'cause he loves me. 'Cause he loves me. 'Cause he loves me.
They worked hard. They did good.
Thank you for joining us here today at Fellowship of the Nations. Here's some things we have coming up. Summer camps are in the works for all of our little ones and students. So pick up information about these at Kid Nation or Student Nation. Grief Share has started a new session and will be meeting through July the 12th. Grief forever changes us, but we don't have to do it alone. A grief shared is divided, and a joy shared is multiplied. So come and join Kieran Allen on Monday nights at 7 o'clock. Looking for a place to connect and serve? Well, the FOTN media team is in need of camera operators, as well as lighting, live stream, and slide operations. Don't worry, we'll train you. So see Pastor Locke or Pastor Lisa if you're interested. Children's Ministry is always looking for new volunteers. If you love kids and want to get a huge blessing, sign up with Kid Nation or Baby Nation this week. Some care groups have started back on Wednesday nights here at FOTN. Updated groups can be found at the Welcome Center. So come and meet your new best friends. Now everybody, go out and have a great week.
Happy birthday, Johnny Brady.
Happy birthday, Johnny.
Happy 65th birthday. I've known you since the 80s, and we were just babies then. But thank you for following God and accepting his call on your life as a pastor. It's very evident that you have a pastor's heart. Termite and I and all the FOTN members are blessed because of it. I've been in full-time ministry, or was in full-time ministry for a long time, and I've met a lot of pastors, but I've never seen one with such a kind, gentle, loving, patient heart as yours. You are the definition of a true pastor with an incredible pastor's heart. So we love you. We're thrilled to celebrate the day you were born, 65 long years ago, and we love you.
And I say amen to that. Johnny, if I go back in time right, Mama said that we were 3 years old, so that would mean that we have known each other for 62 years. We've known each other longer than most people have been alive. And Johnny Brady, it's been an honor, it's been a pleasure, and man, I just want to tell you, you know, I've loved you all my life, and I love you even more as my pastor and my very best friend. I can say you are my very best friend. So, Johnny, I hope this is a real special day. I'm blessed beyond words to be able to just talk to you on your birthday. And I thank God that I'm here to talk to you on your birthday. So, you know, having a friendship like this is so dear and so special. I just praise God for it. And I hope this day is really special. So, happy 65th birthday.
Happy birthday.
Hey, Johnny Brady. Happy birthday. I hear you're turning 65 years old. Let me tell you what, you're a great brother. You have a legacy behind you, 65 years. How many years of that has been preaching the gospel? You have disciples around the world. You have people that you've led to the Lord all over Houston and Texas and in India and around the world. There's so many people, Bible schools that are going on, people being trained for the ministry, people serving God because you have answered the call. And let your latter years be better than your former years, because God's not done with you, brother. God's not done with this ministry. God's not done with your messages. God's not done with the anointing that he's given to you. And I'm excited to see what he has in store for you. And I just wanted to say happy birthday. I want to celebrate with you. I want to celebrate the fact that 65 years ago, God created a man named Johnny Brady, made him into a man of God. So I want to say happy birthday. God bless you.
Happy birthday,
Papa.
Hi, Johnny. We just wanted to wish you happy birthday today. Happy 65th. And we want to tell you how much we love you, how much we've enjoyed being friends with you and Lisa all these years. And so happy that you're our pastors and taking us, always being there for us and taking us through some tough times. Thank you. Happy birthday. We love you.
Johnny, we love you guys so much. Happy birthday. We're excited about 65. We're excited to see what God has in store. And we just want to tell you guys thank you for always, always, always being great friends and great pastors to us. We love you. We're celebrating you.
Hey, JB. Congratulations on another trip around the sun. Hope you have a great birthday.
Happy birthday, Johnny. Sorry I tattled on you so much. You got in trouble all the time when we were little. Not really. But I do want to wish you a happy birthday, and I'm so happy that you're not only my pastor, my brother, but you're my friend. I love you so much. See you soon.
Happy birthday, buddy.
Bye.
Hey, Johnny Brady. Locke Brady. Got a word for you. Happy birthday. Man, I sure love me some Brady people. Johnny, so proud of you. 65. Can you really believe it? And guess what, brother? I'm actually coming to you from El Paso, Texas. I am back in Texas. Anyway, I'm ministering over here this weekend and just want to send a little shout out to you, man. Love you. Love Locke. And of course, Miss Lisa, she's the best. Hey, have a great one. Cinco de Mayo. Bless you. Bye.
We are live from Dawson High School, and I have an awesome photographer named Zoe. You want to show him your face, Zoe?
Hi.
Zoe, you can take your mask off. Zoe's taking the picture because we want to wish my brother in Christ and my good friend, Johnny Brady, a happy 65th. You're an awesome brother, and got many more years to come, and I know you do. Love you guys. Bye-bye.
Happy birthday to my brother from the same mother. We're really proud of you, Johnny.
We love you. I'm so thankful you're my brother.
Hey, Johnny. Happy birthday. I hope you have a really good day. I love you.
Hey, JB. Hope you have a great day. And like she said, a happy, happy birthday.
Happy birthday, Papa. We love you.
You're the best.
You're the best around. Nothing's gonna ever keep.
Let's hear it for Johnny Brady. Can you come up here, please? We love you, Pat. Were you surprised? All right. I'm just going to say a little prayer, and then he's going to do our word up for us this morning. Is that okay? Let's just pray for him. God, we thank you for Pastor Johnny. We thank you for what he means to us, God, what he means to this community, what he means to ministries all over the world, God, but what he means especially to me as a father, and how he's been my godly example, and how he's just walked with me through everything. And I thank you that you would just bless him with more and more years to come, God, and more work to do. You know that he's still got a heart for you and a heart for lost people, and he loves sinners with the same love that you have, Jesus. We thank you for that. We thank you that all of us are here. Some of us wouldn't even be here, God, if it wasn't for Johnny. And I pray that you would just bless him today, God, for his birthday this week, and just remind him how loved he is and how loved he is by you and how well he's done. We thank you for all these things in Jesus' name. Amen, amen.
Well, I'm in shock because I thought it was my 45th birthday, but I guess I'm still in denial. But let me say this. This is my greatest birthday present because he was born on my birthday as well. So we both do it, and I couldn't ask for a better one. Amen. So anyway, I'm gonna be quiet and let him preach.
All right. Well, okay. You want to do the word up? I'll do it. Anybody got the word? All right. Hold it in the air like you really, really care. Let's say it together. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was God, and the Word was with God. Thank you. There's a light into my path. I will hide His Word in my heart so that I might not sin against God. Holy Spirit, give me ears to hear and strength to obey. In Jesus' name, hallelujah. Amen, amen. I got so excited. I've only been doing that for 20 years. I don't know how I forgot. Did you know we started this church in 2000? Anybody know that? Did you know that I was singing up here? That's how old I am. I was singing up here. My big one's next year, so we'll do a big one next year, okay? I'm so glad you're here. I hope you are as well. We're talking about blessed assurance today. We're going to talk about confidence today. Can we talk about confidence? Does anybody need confidence? Anybody feel like they're lacking? All right, let's talk about confidence and where we get it. But we're going to first talk about our memory scripture for today. This is John 3:17. We all know John 3:16, right? This is John 3:17, and it says, God sent His Son into the world not to judge the world, but to save the world through Him. So we're going to say that together. We're going to say the scripture, and then we're going to say the address. Can we do that together, please? All right, you ready? One, two, three. God sent His Son into the world not to judge the world, but to save the world through Him. John 3:17. One more time. God sent His Son into the world not to judge the world, but to save the world through Him. John 3:17. Let's just all take a second and thank God that He sent His Son into the world not to condemn, not to judge, which He had every right to do, but to save the world through Himself. We thank You, Jesus, for that this morning. We bless Your name. Help me preach this message. All right, here we go. So we're talking about confidence and assurance today. Confidence. The self-esteem movement has been going on for at least 30 years. Was anyone taught about self-esteem in school? It's been a miserable failure, but self-esteem, it turns out, is not that important. Anyway, kids today are taught the importance of self-esteem, the amount of emphasis we put on self and confidence and how amazing you are and how empowered you need to feel and how you have to go out there and crush your goals and achieve your dreams. Self-esteem, that's puffing up yourself to think that you're something else, right? Man, I'm really something. That's self-esteem. That's really, I'm pretty great. You just look in the mirror and, man, you're looking good today, you know. That's your self-esteem. Having confidence in yourself. It's a silly concept. The more you get closer to God, you're like, wait a minute, I shouldn't have any confidence in myself because all my confidence belongs to who? Jesus, that's right. So Pastor Stephanie years ago and I were asked to go speak to an elementary school, and they wanted us to talk to the kids about self-esteem because these elementary kids were having suicidal thoughts. Elementary kids were having suicidal thoughts. You understand? This is a spiritual attack. We're going to get to that later. But I did not talk to them about self-esteem. I talked to them about self-worth. Because you, whether you know this or not, have intrinsic, unchanging value. Regardless of where you're from, or what you look like, or what your name is, or what your talents are, or how much you have, or whether you're still in the womb or not, you have value to God. You are a valuable life. You are priceless to Him. That's where my value comes from. That's where my self-worth comes from. Not because of anything that I've done or anything or how I look or what I have. It's because of Christ and what He did for me. Oh, thank You, Jesus. You're priceless to him. The entire story of the Bible is about God desperately pursuing a relationship with us. We can never be good enough to get to him, so he had to come to us. He died for you. I know we hear that all the time. Jesus died for you, but he died for you. That means it cost Jesus everything to have relationship with you. That's what you were worth to him. You understand? So it's not about self-esteem. It's not about who you are. It's about whose you are. Let's just imagine I had a $100 bill here. I should have gotten one, but then I'd have to have taken a $100 bill out of my bank account. I don't want to do that. But we'll just imagine, okay? So I have a $100 bill, and I ask someone to come up, and they say, do you want this $100 bill? What would they say? Yes. Well, what if I crumple it up? It's real wrinkled, you know? And a little ball, and then I take it and I kind of flatten it out. It doesn't look as good. Do you still want it? You do? Okay. What if I put it on the ground and I step on it, do my foot on it like that? And I pick it up. You still want it? Is it still worth $100? Maybe because the value is not in what it looks like. It's not in the paper. It's what it represents. Come on, somebody. It's not about the condition. It's not about what happened to it. It's about what it represents. You represent the King of Kings. You are his child. That's why you are valuable. That's why your value does not change, even if something happens to you. Even if you've been through some stuff, your value is unchanging. Yeah, but you don't know what I did. You don't know what the kind of life I've lived. You don't know the mistakes I've made. You don't know the people I've hurt. You don't know what they've done to me. I'm used up. I'm beat up. And he says, I still died for you. I still did. And I knew what would happen to you, and I still love you, and I'm still pursuing a relationship with you. It does not matter what you look like or what you've been through. You are valuable to God. Are anybody feeling confident yet? Come on, somebody. I'm going to make it through this sermon. Good grief. Proverbs 28:1 says, the wicked run away when no one is chasing them, but the godly are as bold as lions. This is my excuse to never go jogging anywhere. The righteous, the godly, we are to be as bold as lions. And I said, we. I don't mean the godly like there's some other people that are godly. I mean, I'm talking about us. Why? Because of what Jesus did for us, amen? Have you received Christ? Have your sins been washed by the blood of the Lamb of God? Guess what? You're righteous. You're holy. He made you that way. So act like it. Be bold as lions. You remember in school when the teacher asked a question and you knew the answer? You had 100% certainty. I know this answer. How fast did your hand shoot up? Right? You remember that? Somebody, let's go back in our minds for 50-something years for some people, but we're not going to. You had the confidence because you knew the answer. If you have Jesus, you know the answer. So have confidence, all right? Not in yourself, but in Jesus. Somebody's going to get it today. Ephesians 3:8 says, this is Paul talking to Ephesians, he says, though I am the least deserving of all God's people. That doesn't sound very confident. That doesn't sound like high self-esteem to me. But he says, I'm the least deserving of all God's people. He graciously gave me the privilege of telling the Gentiles, that's us, about the endless treasures available to them in Christ. I was chosen to explain to everyone this mysterious plan that God, the creator of all things, had kept secret from the beginning. God's purpose in all this was to use the church to display his wisdom in its rich variety to all the unseen rulers and authorities in the heavenly places. There's a lot in there that I'm not going to explain right now. We're going to just get to this last part. This was his eternal plan, which he carried out through Christ Jesus our Lord. Because of Christ and our faith in him, we can now come boldly and confidently into God's presence. boldly and confidently into God's presence. Who approaches a king with boldness? Fearless. Head high, chest out. That's not how you walk up to a king, is it? Who can do that? A son. A daughter. A child of the king. An heir to the kingdom. That's who can do it. I got into a bit of a philosophical conversation recently with some of my smarter friends. They're not here today, no offense. And I said, whether you think you are deserving of God's love or think you're unworthy of God's love, you're wrong. That really stumped them. That was good. Because we don't deserve it, do we? We never could. Yet he gives it to us freely and abundantly, and we are worthy of it, but only because of the cross. Only because of what Jesus did for us. That's where my confidence comes from. Not that I deserved what he did, but that he made me worthy by doing it. You understand? That's where your value comes from. The value of something is how much someone is willing to pay for it. And he paid everything for me. That's my value. Hebrews 4:14 says, therefore, since we have a great high priest who has ascended to heaven. Who's that? Jesus, the Son of God. Let us hold firmly to the faith we profess, for we do not have a high priest who is unable to empathize with our weaknesses, but we have one who has been tempted in every way, just as we are, yet he did not sin. I'm going to take one more second here. God, thank you that you are not unable to empathize with our weaknesses, but you have been tempted in every way. You know exactly what we feel. You know exactly what we go through, and you showed us how to do it. You showed us how to live it, and you've given us the power to achieve it. We thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. I'm sorry, I just need one more little break there. Let us then approach God's throne of grace with confidence so that we may receive mercy and find grace to help us in our time of need. Who needs mercy and grace in here? Anybody? I do. So if that's what I got to do to receive mercy and grace, I will then approach the throne of grace with confidence. Approach his throne. When we enter into worship, we should do so with confidence. Can we talk about this for just a second? Not timidity, confidence. Get loud. I beg you guys every week, let's sing loud. And I got these things in my ears up here, I know. But I still want to be able to hear you guys sing loud. I want to look out and see people singing loud. Getting indignant. Shameless. Why? Because you know what God did for you. You know what he did. And it's worth getting loud about. Come on. The goodness of God demands a response, and it should be thanksgiving and praise and adoration and loud singing and clapping and moving around for crying out loud. Can we move around a little bit sometimes? We got this rocking band, and we're looking at a bunch of, it looks like looking at a painting sometimes. I don't want to get too critical of you guys. It's like a painting of people. I'm like, can y'all kind of, you know, some of this? You know. Come on, white people. White people know all about the thumbs. And then they do the overbite. Let him know how you feel about what he's done. So get bold in your worship. 2 Timothy 1. I don't know if you know, but I'm trying to rush through this thing so everybody can go home and use the bathroom. Second Timothy 1:7 says, for God has not given us a spirit of fear and timidity, but of power, love, and self-discipline. You know what this tells me? It tells me that fear is a spirit, and it should be dealt with on a spiritual level. You feel overcome with fear? Speak to it. Rebuke it. Drive it out. Bind it off your heart and mind. kick it out of your house. You are filled with the Holy Spirit of Almighty God. Act like it. Greater is he who's in me than any spirit of fear that comes to hinder me. Any assignment of the enemy, any devil that wants to attack me, my kids, my ministry, hands off. You're not welcome. You're not allowed here. Quit thinking that it's just an emotional problem or a chemical problem or you didn't get enough sleep or you ate the wrong thing. Fear is a spirit. And if you're living life gripped in fear and overcome by fear and it's keeping you from living your life and doing what God called you to do, talk to it. With authority. In the name of Jesus, you have to get out. And watch him run. The scripture tells me that he does not want us to live in fear. That's not part of his plan. That's not what he wants for your life. And in this season, I want him to just be afraid for 6 months. No, that's not part of it. So get rid of it. Isaiah 41 says, So do not fear, for I am with you. Do not be dismayed, for I am your God. I will strengthen you and help you. I will uphold you with my righteous right hand. All who rage against you will surely be ashamed and disgraced. Come on, somebody. Those who oppose you will be as nothing and perish. Though you search for your enemies, you will not find them. Those who wage war against you will be as nothing at all. For I am the Lord your God who takes hold of your right hand and says to you, do not fear. I will help you. I love the idea of the Lord God taking hold of my right hand. Just think about that for a second. He knows you're scared. He knows what you're going through is scary. And he says, hold my hand. And don't fear. I've held my kids' hands walking through a parking lot or crossing the street. And they walk with confidence when I'm holding their hand. Not because they know where they're going or what to do, but they know that I know. And they know that they're safe with me. Right? In my life, I don't always know where to go or what to do, but I know he knows, and I know for certain that he loves me and that I'm safe with him. So what do I have to fear? If I'm holding God's hand, what am I afraid of? Why am I not walking with confidence? Confidence is faith. Confidence is saying that I trust you, God. I trust that you're smarter than I am. I trust that you know better than I do. And I'm going to follow where you lead. Jesus taught a lot of parables. We all know the popular ones like the prodigal son or the good Samaritan or the sower and the seed or the 99 sheep. But this one is what I would call a deep cut. This one is so funny to me. I love it so much. This one is called The Friend at Midnight. Anybody ever heard this one? This is called The Friend at Midnight. You ready? Then teaching them more about prayer. That's the subject of this parable. Prayer. All right? He used this story. He says, suppose you went to a friend's house at midnight, wanting to borrow 3 loaves of bread. You say to him, a friend of mine has just arrived for a visit, and I have nothing for him to eat. And suppose he calls out from his bedroom. He's asleep. He calls out from his bedroom. Don't bother me. The door is locked for the night. And my family and I are all in bed. I can't help you. Which is a very reasonable thing to say to someone bugging you at midnight for bread. But I tell you this, though he won't do it for friendship's sake, if you keep knocking long enough, he will get up and give you whatever you need because of your shameless persistence. This is a story about prayer. Don't miss this, okay? Your shameless persistence. And so I tell you, keep on asking, and you will receive what you ask for. Keep on seeking, and you will find. Keep on knocking, and the door will be open to you. For everyone who asks receives, everyone who seeks finds, and to everyone who knocks, the door will be open. Ask, seek, knock. A-S-K. Come on, somebody. Wow. Jesus is telling us a secret about how the kingdom of God works. He's saying that God our Father rewards persistence. Persistence is not for the faint of heart. It's not for the weak and weary. It's for people who are tenacious and will not give up asking for what they need from God. And he's saying, you keep asking, you might just get it. Don't give up. Anybody ever pray for something for more than 5 years? 10 years, anybody? It's not easy, is it? It just becomes part of your life. Well, I'm going to pray for this again. I'm going to keep knocking. I'm just going to keep doing it. You might pray for something that long, and then God showed up one day and just... And you weren't expecting it, were you? Because why would you? Yeah, you've prayed this 10,000 times, and God just said, here you go. Wait a minute. You're saying that worked? I just kept asking and it worked? Jesus is saying, yes. Keep asking. Come on. He responds to shameless repetition. In fact, he sees it as a pleasing act of faith. He's telling us, don't give up. Man, it's hard not to give up sometimes. It might be my generation that just decided to give up on things immediately, and we handed it down to our kids, hopefully not. But it got hard by, you talk to you like your grandparents or people who maybe lived through the Depression, and you wonder why they never throw anything away. Because when things get broken, they don't just throw it out. They try to fix it, make it work again. We're like, no, just kidding. I don't need it. I give up. I don't want it. You ask one time, and God says, no, or not right now. And you go, okay. I didn't need it that much. How much do you want it? God wants to see how much you want it. He wants to see if you're going to give up when it doesn't happen right away. So this is going to require boldness. This is going to challenge your ego and your pride, okay? Because you might not have to come up here during a worship service and lay on your face somewhere here at the altar and cry out to God for what you need. You might have to fast. You might have to do without some things. You might have to push your plate away. If that's what it takes, then that's what I'm going to do, right? Because he rewards my shameless persistence. Luke 11 says, this is a continuation of that, says, you fathers, if your children ask for a fish, do you give them a snake instead? Or if they ask for an egg, do you give them a scorpion? That's a mean dad, isn't it? Of course not. So if you sinful people know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more? Somebody say, how much more? Will your heavenly Father give the Holy Spirit to those who ask him? Wait a minute. He will give the Holy Spirit. He's telling us how vital the Holy Spirit is to our success in the kingdom. He's telling us if you really want to ask God for something you desperately need, ask for more of the Holy Spirit. The more you learn about what God wants for your life, what he's calling you to do, where he's calling you to go, the more you realize, I can't do any of this in my own power. I need the Holy Spirit for everything. I need him in abundance. I need filling to overflowing with the Holy Spirit. I can't do anything of importance or achieve anything of value for the kingdom without the Holy Spirit as my power source. I need him. Man, I got quiet on that one. Psalms 27:1 says, "The Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? The Lord is the stronghold of my life. Of whom shall I be afraid? When the wicked advance against me to devour me, it is my enemies and my foes who will stumble and fall. Though an army besiege me, and my heart will not fear. Though war break out against war, hang on. Though war break out against me, even then I will be confident." You have enemies, and I want to be very clear on this part because we're almost done, but they are not flesh and blood. As much as our flesh wants to make enemies out of people, our battle is not with people. The lesson is not an easy one to learn. It's not an easy pill to swallow because what? People hurt us. They betray us and steal from us and lie about us and slander us and abuse us and take advantage of us. People God loves do this to you. People he's commanded us to love. People he's commanded us to forgive. But wait a minute, God, you don't know what they did to me. You don't know how they hurt me. You don't know what they said about me and how they treated me. You ever said that? I can't forgive them. You saw what they did. Wait a minute. After Jesus was beaten, tortured, and forced up a hill, laid on a wooden cross and nailed to it, and lifted up for everyone to see, mocked and laughed at, he said, "Father, forgive them. They don't know what they're doing." He was teaching us to forgive. And let me tell you something else. If I can't forgive, I can't be forgiven. If I can't forgive, I cannot be forgiven. And it really is that simple to me. And I hope it can get that simple to someone in here today. It really comes down to, I need to be right with God, and I can't get right until I let this go. This will hurt when you do this. It will not feel good. But it's necessary. It's necessary. And this person and what they did, hanging on to that anger and gripping onto that grudge, you know, it's not worth my peace. It's not worth my joy. It's not worth my relationship with God. It's just not. Not worth it. Let it go. Let it go. I don't know if I can let it go. The Holy Spirit is here today to help you let it go. And your peace will return. And your joy will return. And your fellowship with God will return. And you'll say, "Why did I wait so long? Why did I hang on to that thing so long when I didn't need to? And I was only hurting myself." I'm going to jump down just a second. I'm going to jump down to that last scripture, John 10, 25. Oh, man, you guys are on it. Thank you so much. Jesus, can we have a little hand for our media team? They really go above and beyond, and I swear I'm going to learn all your names someday. Jesus answered, "I did tell you, you do not believe. The works I do in my Father's name testify about me, but you do not believe because you are not my sheep." He's talking to these Pharisees who are questioning him. He says, "My sheep listen to my voice. I know them, and they follow me. I give them eternal life, and they shall never perish. No one will snatch them out of my hand. My Father who has given them to me is greater than all. No one can snatch them out of my Father's hand. I and the Father are one." If you don't hear anything else today, I want you to get this. No one can snatch them out of my Father's hand, he said. That means you're right here and you're surrounded by the Father. And that's where I want to be. That's where I want to abide. I want to be a branch on the vine in the center of his will, under his protection and provision, surrounded by his goodness and mercy, forgiving as I've been forgiven, loving as I've been loved, right here. I want to be this close to the Father. And when I am, I'm living in the confidence that I'm a child of the King. I'm filled and empowered by His Holy Spirit. I have purpose prepared for me before I was born. And I can walk boldly into the presence of Almighty God, righteous in His eyes because of the blood of Jesus, and how He's made me clean and holy and worthy of all God has for me. That's where your confidence comes from. Not because of what you can do, but because you were available to do it when He called you. That's when we get used by God. Let's pray. God, we thank You this morning for Your goodness and mercy. We thank You for the privilege of being called Your children. We thank You that everything You've called us to do, You have empowered us to do by the Holy Spirit. And we can walk with the confidence that we are filled with Your Spirit. And we know Your will. We know the work we have to do. We bless Your name. If you're here this morning and you don't know this relationship with Jesus I'm talking about, we're going to give you a chance right now to be introduced to Him. If you want to receive Jesus this morning, let His blood wash away your sins. Be clean and holy and forgiven in His sight. And walk in the new life that He's called you to. I'm going to ask you to say a prayer. We're all going to say it together. And you say it with all your heart, if that's you this morning. Let's pray this together. Repeat after me. Dear Lord Jesus, thank You for loving me. Thank You for dying on the cross for my sins. I have sinned against You, and I'm sorry. I repent of my sins. I turn from my wicked ways, and I turn to You, Jesus. I open the door to my heart, and I invite You to come in. Forgive me of my sins. Wash me clean with Your precious blood. Save my soul. Give me eternal life. Baptize me in the power of Your Holy Spirit so I may live for You, serve You, obey Your word, and love You all the days of my life. I ask in faith, and I believe in my heart, that You, Jesus, rose again on the third day so that I could be saved today. Thank You, Jesus, for saving my soul. You are my Lord. You are my God. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
I want to thank you so much for being a part of our online streaming. I hope you really enjoyed the message today. And I want you to just take it to heart. Whatever the Lord has spoken to you, just take it to heart. And I pray that if you have never received Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, that today would be that day. The Bible says today is the day of salvation. So that's what we're praying for you. And if you're wondering, how do I get to know Jesus as my Lord and Savior? Well, let me tell you, it's pretty simple. First of all, Jesus loves you more than anybody on this planet. So let me tell you, He's wanting you to know Him. So as you come to Him, we recognize, one, that we've sinned against God. Everybody has. The Bible says that all have sinned. We've fallen short of the glory of God. Well, we recognize that one. We don't have to be told that. We know that. The second thing is, it says that God demonstrated His love for us, and that's you. God loves you even though that we were sinners. That's how much He cares for you. So you got to get it out of the way. He's not judging you. He already sent His Son to die in our place so that we could have all of our sin placed upon Him. And then we believe, we had faith in Him, that that's what He did. And He did it because He loved us. The Bible says the wages of our sin is death. Well, Jesus took our death sentence for us. But then it doesn't leave it as a negative. It says, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus. It's not works. It's not a church membership somewhere. It's not giving money to somebody. All of those are good things, but this does not bring salvation. So now, how do you get there? It's only in Jesus. So simply just open your heart and say, Jesus, I'm a sinner. Please forgive me of my sin. Come into my heart. Save me. Forgive me. I want to turn away from all the stupid stuff that I'm doing. And I want to turn to you. I want you to be my Lord, my Savior, the boss of my life. And Jesus, come in and save me. I want to love you. I want to live for you. I want to obey your word all the days of my life. And that's what you can do. Pray that prayer right now. And I tell you, Jesus is waiting. And the moment, the instant you do that, you will be saved. And my encouragement to you, find a great Bible-believing, Bible-preaching church. Get connected. Now, if you're in the Houston area, man, we would love to have you at Fellowship of the Nations. But you're in different parts of the country or even around the world, find somewhere that they're preaching Jesus. And I promise you, it will change your life. Hope you can join us again next week. And up until then, we'll be praying for you. Pray for us. We'd love to hear from you. Just go on our website, FOTN.org, Fellowship of the Nations, and let us hear from you. God bless you.